human for some reason. All the training we've done over the years and the meetings, you guys, it's always human. We don't know why, but. Can he come in if he's next and stand by?
Yeah, he can come on in and have a seat. Have a seat or wave.
Would you describe describe the investigation on your involvement in on this particular disciplinary action?
Sure. I'm not thinking I can refer to the date. Yeah. The May of 2011, like every other month, we have in-service training with the sheriff's office. That typically includes a four-hour block of instruction, sometimes a little more, sometimes a little less. So we keep our hours up with post and any kind of continual training with them. The training is mandatory. Like anything else, just like a regular scheduled shift, if you're scheduled for that training, you're supposed to show up in there. And we understand that sometimes officers can't make it for whatever reason. We typically will excuse them ahead of time. And in fact, the procedure has always been that if they were going to miss, we needed to excuse them ahead of time, outside of some sort of emergency or exigency, sickness or something like that. In this particular month, Mr. Skowronski missed that in-service training. And because of that, the sergeant at the time, Sergeant Matonis, chose to do a disciplinary action recommendation on him for missing that, and to do it under absence without leave, since in our eyes, it's essentially the same thing as missing the shift, where you were supposed to report for duty and you don't report for duty. I concurred with it. We chose to give him written counseling, hopefully in an effort to try to correct that so that he would understand the importance of showing up when he's supposed to show up for the training.
Did Mr. Skowronski know that he was supposed to attend the training?
He did. The in-service training is published several months ahead of time. The training section gives out a calendar every 6 months, January and June, to let you know what the coming up dates are. In addition to that, they send out email reminders. In addition to that, as a lieutenant or sergeant on the shift, we will often remind the guys, hey, listen, we have in-service, this is the date, this is the time. We have in-service, this is the date, this is the time. And we'll do that in our regular briefings before we start shift.
What reason did Mr. Skowronski give in his statement?
He forgot. Quite simply, they just slipped his mind and forgot.
And that's why, at that time, you recommended written counsel.
Correct.
I have no further questions.
Awesome, man. How you doing, sir?
Good, how you doing, sir?
In regards to this, the AWOL, was I ever absent from training prior to that?
None that I am aware of that required a gun disciplinary action.
Was I absent or late after that without being given notification?
None that I'm aware of. While you work with me, anyways.
If somebody's late or doesn't show up on time, what's the general practice for people that work in the department?
For in-service or for?
In-service.
Yeah, generally in-service, because we have a number of them. For instance, an in-service class will last two sessions a day for 3 or 4 days a week, and we'll do it for 2 weeks to make sure we can accommodate people's schedules. And people will often choose an in-service time that fits their schedule. And unless it is a specific sign-up, where we said, no, this is the one you signed up for and you must do it. So if people don't sign up for in-service, if they don't show up, there will generally be a call or an inquiry at some point by the sergeant, hey, did you make it to in-service? If they're supposed to be there specifically that day, we'll call them like we do anything else and say, where are you? Why aren't you here? But if it's a general in-service and has several things, you can just pick and choose what fits your schedule. We simply will check back later on and say, hey, I didn't see the one we went to. Did you go to another one?
On this particular day, did the majority of the shift go that day?
I don't recall. I would imagine so.
To your knowledge, did anybody attempt to call me and say, hey,
don't know.
You have training?
It's my knowledge, though.
So, to your knowledge, nobody called you and said, hey, we got training right now, where are you?
Yeah, to my knowledge, no, they did not.
Which is a common courtesy, a common practice. When you show up to training, you see somebody who's not there.
Yeah, it would be a common courtesy for your fellow officers to call, certainly. You know, there's nothing that dictates that a sergeant or supervisor has to call and inquire about it.
I understand. It's not nothing dictated or nothing really policy, but it is common practice.
Common practice on the ones that you're signed up for. Not as much common practice on one where there are several different. So we don't know if you've gone to a different one or we're planning on going to a different one.
Have you ever known me to lie or be dishonest?
I have not.
In regards to any mistakes I've ever made while working for you, have I freely admitted to them?
You have.
Have I accepted the consequences?
You have.
Even though I complain about it?
Oh, sure, yeah. Mm-hmm. Always complaining, but you always accepted it.
In a serious situation, out on patrol, is there any doubt in your mind that I wouldn't be there to back you up?
No.
Can you say that of everybody in the department that you work with?
No. There are some I have questions about.
In regards to the Avenue incident, what did you discuss that with Captain Hoffman or anybody else?
Yeah, we had some brief discussions. Not a lot of in-depth. Since I wasn't your current supervisor at the time, but some brief over discussions.
What was the gist of it? Did he ask you for a recommendation or anything like that?
No, I didn't. He didn't. I wasn't in the process anywhere for him, but no recommendation like that.
In regards to the other incident regarding evidence, were you privy to that information?
You'll have to refresh my memory.
Marijuana that was left in my trunk, that was turned in late.
Yeah, I remember something about it. I think most of what I heard about it came from you, but I don't recall.
Do you remember the conversation we had? That I was talking to you about Lieutenant Fisher and what he had told me?
I don't. You'll have to refresh my memory.
At one point in our conversation, our many conversations we've had, I explained to you that Lieutenant Fisher told me nothing was going to come out of that.
Right. Yep.
And then afterwards, I sought your advice when I did get suspended for that on how to approach that. You recall that?
Briefly. If I recall correctly, I think we were talking about it, and I think I told you, if he told you that there was going to be no punishment, and there ended up being punishment, that probably wasn't the correct thing to do. And I got personally have an issue with that. I think I also recall letting you know that sometimes as things go up the chain of command, things change. But I would have from what I recall of our conversation, I think I would have a personal issue with Fisher for saying what he said. It may be even a little bit of ground to have an argument about the punishment itself. But I don't recall a whole lot of decisions past that.
How long have you been with the sheriff's office?
11 years.
In your 11 years here, have you seen other people get disciplined or have major infractions that the discipline did not fit?
Uh,
Either too late, too early, or too much?
Well,
I would again raise the same objection that what was done to other employees, whether now or during a previous administration, isn't relevant, nor would Lieutenant Boone have much knowledge of those things unless he was directly involved.
Yeah, let me ask you, rephrase the question. And if you have a specific example that you're asking about, go ahead, but it needs to have some relationship to what your situation is. To the extent it shows that you, that the sheriff is biased in terminating you, or you were terminated for discriminatory purposes, I'll allow it. It's kind of a general question about what you're asking. That's kind of open.
I'll refer back to Tom Malone, the previous employee. Were you aware of the infractions that he committed?
Not the formal one, but the, you know, scuttlebutt.
For yes. And I would again object. He had no direct involvement, which he just testified to in that. No decision making, no involvement in that. Just rumor. And again, I would object that he has. There's no relevance for what he might have heard, or since he had no involvement.
Why don't you ask him what he knows about that situation? If he had any direct information, or was involved in any way, or what he heard was just based on what people told him.
Did you have any direct knowledge of what transpired?
No, still a bunch of. If it makes it easier, I've never been involved in any kind of chain of discipline that's in the termination. Mm-hmm. This would be my first one, so that helps to answer you a little bit.
Of in-service training and prior to, more than once, verbally written. Would you agree with that?
You're correct. We announce it several times at our shift briefing before we go on duty. Don't forget we have in-service coming up. This is the day. These are the days and times.
Not enough
questions.
Did I try to make any excuses for missing training?
Nope, you just simply said that you'd forgotten and you're upset that nobody had given you a call.
All right, before I ask members of the board, we got this, I guess it's air conditioning, so just so to make sure we're getting everything on tape, kind of raise your voices a little bit. Members of the board, do any of you have any questions?
No, sir.
Give it up.
Okay. All right. Thank you. This witness may be excused. Call your next witness.
Thank you, Lieutenant Boone.
Sure. Next witness will be Chrissy Barber.
Did you have her?
Sure. Thank you. Barber, and I'm an admin senior in the fleet and supply unit.
Okay, well, one more time?
I'm an admin senior in the fleet and supply unit.
Okay. If you could, we're tape recording this.
Okay.
This is air conditioning floor right behind you, so
okay.
If you could speak up just a little bit.
Sure.
All right. Go ahead. Sorry.
I'd like to tender exhibit 5.
Describe what occurred in this incident with Mr. Skowronski that caused you to write this statement.
Yes, sir. I arrived at the South Precinct late that afternoon to do a special shirt fitting for the sheriff at the time, and he had specified that he wanted everyone to be in their vest that they have to wear under their uniforms. So the email that I had sent out prior to this to all the supervisors to let them know to please make sure all of their guys and gals were in their vest so I could go ahead and fit them for the shirts and get the correct size, because the sizing can be different if they don't have the vest on.
So it's bulletproof vest?
Yes, sir. So when I arrived at South Precinct, I had fitted everyone, and Mr. Skowronski was the last one that arrived in the room, and he did not have his vest. So I kindly asked him to please make sure he had his vest to try on, like I had made sure to send in the email prior to arriving. And he told me he didn't have his fucking vest, and he was not going to wear his fucking vest, and he didn't have to put his fucking vest on. And it just kind of, I didn't know how to react at that point, because I didn't really know him beforehand, so I didn't know if that was just him or if he was upset, or so I just didn't really, but it just, so as I was packing my things up and I got ready to leave, of course I was crying and I was upset because I didn't know how to take it or what to happen, and one of the lieutenants at that time stopped me as I was leaving and asked me what was wrong. So I had to explain to him what had happened. He took it to his supervisor, then his supervisor took it to my supervisor, and then I was told I needed to put it in writing as to what had happened since it had upset me so badly. So.
In your job in supply, is this normal language that you hear from officers when you're doing things to assist them in your job?
Oh, no, sir.
So this was shocking to you?
Very.
And you described it upset you?
Yes, sir.
To the point where you were crying? What was it, other than the language, if anything, that upset you and that
I was just frustrated because I was trying to do the job that my supervisor asked me to do, and and I felt that I had sent the information to his supervisor, and I just felt that there was no cooperation there, and that's all I was asking for, so I could do it the way it needed to be done for what I was asked for. So I think it was frustration and just in shock. I mean, I really was in shock. But like I said, I didn't know him or had not talked to him before this, so I didn't know if that was just, you know, the type of person that he was, or if he was having a bad day, or however, either way, I still didn't feel that I should be talked to that way or put in that position.
No further questions. Have you ever had any other issues with any other employee?
No.
None in the entire time?
No.
At that time, was it not policy that vests weren't required to be worn?
That is correct. It was not policy that it would have been worn. However, I did send an email to all supervisors saying that it had to be because due to the fact that shirts fit differently,
correct.
We had to get the correct shirts.
So. This shirt that was being fitted for, was I able to wear that shirt?
I'm not your supervisor, so I don't know if you're able to wear it or not.
During that time, I explained to you, during our conversation, mm-hmm. that I was not able to wear that shirt. So
okay.
It really did not matter whether it fitted properly or not, due to the tattoo policy.
Okay.
Do you recall having had a tooth back towards you?
No.
Were there any other incidents between us prior to that or afterwards?
No. The only thing afterwards that I do have to say is it was brought to my attention that you preferred not to come in to get things if you had to deal with me, which, you know, that's neither here nor there, but we had no incidents between you and I afterwards, no.
But were you aware of anybody else having that policy about you?
No.
Because I was told by other people the same thing.
Are you ready?
No, sir.
Any questions by any board members?
Mr. Beard?
No, sir.
Dr. Howell?
No, sir.
I'll do that.
Thank you.
Okay.
May I be excused?
Do I take this with me or go back to you?
Sergeant Donnie Daves.
Okay,
time as a sergeant at the sheriff's office, have you supervised Mr. Skowronski when you worked here?
Yes, sir, I have.
And in that time that you supervised him, have you had discussions with him about his use of inappropriate language, swear words, harsh swear words?
Yes, sir, I did.
Would you describe to the board what those discussions involved?
Yes, I had received a complaint from
supply quartermaster, Chrissy Barber, that she had, actually, let me preface that. Supply had been down at South Precinct, and they had uniforms, new uniforms for us to try. They were polo-type shirts, and it was required that each officer would have to try on that shirt because the fitment was possibly wrong as far as a medium may take a small, and if you wore a large, you may take a medium because they, the size of the ran a little large. So they said that you had to try everything on. I had a, well, I don't remember what type of correspondence it was. It may have been a formal complaint, I'm not sure. From Ms. Barber, who's a quartermaster, said that Deputy Skowronski had been in and that he had used offensive language more than once. And I actually quoted that in my notes. I spoke with Deputy Skowronski. He did confirm that that language was used. He gave his reasoning for using that language, but he confirmed that it was used. Other people that were there that I interviewed didn't necessarily hear those exact words, but they did hear the tone that was being used, and they pretty much confirmed the fact. Actually, Deputy Skowronski confirmed the fact that he used that language as well. That is against our policy for professional image. Then wrote out a disciplinary action report for professional image for using that language, and gave Deputy Skowronski, took it up the chain, was approved, came back down for a written reprimand, and that's what I gave Deputy Skowronski when it came back down.
Exhibit 5, which we've already tendered on page 4, this is your memorandum that you sent on this discipline action. Would you read what you wrote in that first paragraph about what Deputy Skowronski's response was?
Yes, first paragraph toward the end, Barbara advised him that he would need to put his vest on for the fitting. Barbara stated Skowronski's response was, "I don't wear my fucking vest. I don't have my fucking vest. I will not put my fucking vest on." Barbara stated that conversation came to an end shortly thereafter.
Is that what Mr. Skowronski told you when you talked to him that he had said?
I am not, I can't quote that. I'd have to look back at my notes there. He verified that he did use curse words. I honestly don't remember if that's exactly what he said verbatim. I know that he agreed that yes, he did say that, but I don't know if it was verbatim. I didn't ask him if he said verbatim or not. That's that direct quote was what Chrissy, actually Ms. Barber, had told me. But he did confirm the fact that he did swear to it.
Would you tell the board why, as a supervisor, did you find that behavior was inappropriate, that precipitated your discipline?
Yeah, I did find it inappropriate. The fact is that us as police officers, we do use inappropriate language from time to time. Usually it's whenever we're in the heat of battle in a fight or something like that, or trying to gain the suspect's attention. But when you're in a controlled environment and it is another employee of the sheriff's office, no matter how frustrated you are with something, that is not the time or the place to use inappropriate language. Therefore, I thought that tarnished the professional image that Skowronski should have portrayed in that one time as a police officer. And that's why I wrote up the disciplinary action.
And what did you either discuss with Skowronski, or what is your opinion of how that situation should have been handled based on his frustration that he that was described?
Well, let me preface it, the whole frustration that Deputy Skowronski had at that point in time was the fact that we also have a policy that states that you cannot wear any exposed body art. Deputy Skowronski has exposed body art on his arm, therefore he couldn't wear these short sleeve shirts that were being fitted to begin with. So in my narrative, I wrote that I can see on the summation, I can see how he could be frustrated. However, he can't point that frustration out toward this individual who has absolutely nothing to do with this policy. That frustration should be not vented in that avenue, vented later on to someone else, maybe, I don't know, maybe to a supervisor, to me. However, there's nothing I can do to change the policy. We have policies and rules for a reason. That Ms. Skowronski knew that policy and that rule was there. He violated because he was frustrated. Did I understand that he was frustrated? Maybe he shouldn't have had to do the fitting? Possibly. However, he can't take that frustration out on an individual who has absolutely nothing to do with it, just trying to do a job.
No further questions.
Pretty good. Did you recall if we had a conversation with firemen going to that one?
Prior to you going to the exhibit?
No.
Do you remember me asking, coming to you and saying, why am I going to this? Because I can't wear the name shirt anymore?
Yes.
Okay. And, that was my chief concern, major complaint, was I'm going for a fitting that I can't wear a shirt. So why am I being fitted for it? At the time, policy stated we didn't have to wear our vests, correct?
Yes, it did.
So I would be well within my right not to put my vest on because I didn't wear it anyway.
Yes.
Right. Doran, you're talking with other people. Was there the tone that was described, was it two-way or was it one-way?
As far as the investigation, was it two-way as far as you and
her,
the quartermaster
or
yourself?
Was it just me towards her?
Through the investigation, it was only one-way. That's through the investigation.
Do you remember having a conversation after the investigation was complete with me about it?
Yes.
And what did you say? Do you recall the gist of what you said? What was your opinion of the complaint?
The complaint, well, my opinion of the complaint was there are always two sides to the story. Mm-hmm. However, the only thing I have is this side. Right. And that if you decided that this was the wrong thing to do, inappropriate thing to do, as far as the vest and everything, you still have to suck it up and you have to go on and you have to take the fit.
Right.
And you shouldn't have talked to her anyway, regardless as well.
Sure. At any point during this time, you recall telling me it's bullshit?
No. Mm-hmm. I don't.
In regards to complaints, your hands are pretty much tied up as far as when you get a complaint, correct? You have to follow through regardless of whether you think it's completely
false. Yes, an investigation has to happen.
How long have we known each other?
When did you start? 2008? Since 2008.
Have you ever known me to lie to you?
Never.
Be dishonest?
Never.
Even in this instance, with this particular disciplinary, did I try to make excuses?
No.
Deny anything?
No, sir, you're completely honest.
Is it safe to say throughout all our interactions on work that if I was available, you would request me for backup?
I'm sorry, what was your question?
If during work, you mean PD,
right.
If there was a situation going on and I was available, would you request me as backup?
I usually didn't have to request you as backup. You usually showed up anyway. The answer to the question is yes.
And why did I show up usually anyway?
Because you enjoyed the job.
In your own personal opinion, do you think I was a good police officer?
I think that, we're talking about my opinion. In my opinion, I think that as far as doing the work, the actual physical work, I think that you were excellent at your job. in terms of what language you use, when you use it, what tone you use, was sometimes a little inappropriate, even on calls we ran on. And I brought this up to you before, too. Yes. However, I did realize that you came from another agency where that kind of language may have been tolerated. And that kind of tone, and that abrasiveness that may make up with it. But as far as doing your job, did I think that you did a bad job?
No.
But I think you did a good job.
Have you worked with any other deputies that have used abusive language personally?
Most every deputy that I have worked with the exception of one in particular, has used some type of language. It's the atmosphere in which it's used.
Correct.
It's different.
The atmosphere with the Chrissy Barber incident, that was in the precinct.
It was.
That atmosphere is usually pretty laid back, and there is a lot of person going on in that environment, is there not?
No.
Inside the precinct.
And can I explain my answer for no? That was a special event that happened inside. And let me bring this up. There are Boy Scout troops that come inside the precinct as well.
Correct.
And that kind of language and actions are not tolerated then. This is the same room that we have the Boy Scout troops in. However, it's the quartermaster down there. So, at that point in time, no, it is not common for that kind of language to happen. Any other time, is it pretty common? Yes. But during special events that come on?
No. So, if a person who works for the sheriff's department has been around police officers for however many years, was previously married to one, wouldn't it be safe to say that she's heard the language before?
Possibly. I don't know. It was relayed to me that it was very offensive. Mm-hmm. And I can only go by what the person tells me.
Yeah. Okay. As far as me and you going back to work stuff, at any time during a serious incident, would you have a problem with me being your backup?
Oh, no. No, I've answered that.
Can you say the same thing about every other person you've worked with in this department?
No, you cannot.
That's all I have.
Sergeant Boy Avery, Gregg.
Yes, sir. Sergeant Dave. If you knew that Mr. Skowronski had turned in a timesheet to get paid for a job that he did not do, or did a very small portion of, would that change your opinion of whether he was a good cop or someone that you would want to work at the sheriff's office?
If I had hard evidence, yes.
So the fact that he may have been good at his job doesn't change the fact that based on other actions that he might have done, he might still have violated the policy and done things that were serious enough to be disciplined or terminated. Would you agree with that?
I would agree, yes.
And on this particular incident, you recommended the punishment as his first line supervisor because you felt it was inappropriate, as you testified to. And on Exhibit 5, which they have, everybody above you concurred with that opinion. That this was not just your opinion, is that correct?
That's correct.
All the way to and including the sheriff?
Yes, sir. All disciplinary actions go up the chain, and it's the supervisor either concurs or disagrees, but in this case, all the supervisors above me concurred with my findings.
That's all.
Questions by the board members?
Mr. Baird.
No, sir.
Thank you.
I'm going to testify to the next incident as a witness. Exhibit is a disciplinary action recommendation for conduct on becoming on and off duty for Mr. Skowronski that occurred in February of 2012.
What is it marked?
Exhibit 6.
And how are you familiar with that document?
This document is part of the discipline that is in Mr. Skowronski's file in our Office of Internal Affairs, where the discipline is kept.
Do you have any objection to FC6? Admitted without objection, would you like to publish it?
Yes, sir. Secretary, is Gina Estes, and in that conversation, Ms. Estes reported to Sergeant Latonis later that he had used some foul language with her, that his attitude was very aggressive and intimidating, that she felt intimidated by him over this phone conversation. Sergeant Latonis investigated this complaint from the school where Ms. Estes worked, and it was recommended for a written counseling for Mr. Skowronski for violating conduct unbecoming on or off duty for using profanity over the telephone to Ms. Estes. And Ms. Estes did know Mr. Skowronski as he had come to the school, and so she knew that he was a deputy of the sheriff's office when he called her and talked to her on the phone, and that this is prohibited conduct under our policy for destroying the respect of the sheriff's office by acting this way toward an administrative person at the school. Before this, Mr. Skowronski was given a written counsel.
Anything further?
Sergeant Boyd, were you directly involved in any course of this investigation?
No, I was not.
As far as your knowledge, did I identify myself as a deputy at that time?
Not that I'm aware of.
Are you familiar with the circumstances regarding the incident?
That it had to do with an incident on the school bus where you were concerned for, I believe, your girlfriend's daughter?
No, sir. It was my child.
It was your child?
My child. My eight-year-old son. Do you have any children, sir?
Yes.
If you were presented with the same circumstances, that a bus is not allowing your eight-year-old son, who is crying on the bus, to get off, what would you do?
I would be concerned.
Mm-hmm. Would you want to know what's going on?
I'm sure I would.
Mm-hmm. Would you call the school?
If I felt that would solve the problem.
Mm-hmm. Now, given the circumstances of it being your child, your eight-year-old, and you can see him crying on the bus and wondering why he's not getting off, do you think you would be elevated when you made that phone call?
Yes.
I understand that not everybody speaks the same way. I do tend to curse a lot. Do you think anybody else in that situation may have cursed?
I'm not sure. I'm sure somebody could. I don't swear, so I don't have a reference.
Now, it says, by Sergeant Latonis, memorandum, that complaints were made, but only one was sustained. Do you know the reason for that?
The investigation into what occurred at the bus stop and in the school bus was unfounded. The discipline was for the conversation that you had with the secretary.
Mm-hmm. At that time, were you aware that, or are you aware now, that the day that they called Sergeant Latonis and he showed up to the school, that the principal sent out an email school-wide asking for any issues they've ever had with me, Larry, and with my, while dealing with me in regards to my son?
No.
Sergeant Latonis was aware of that. So, one incident of cursing wound up turning into four or five different complaints. One complaint, but four or five different charges, per se. Right. What exactly?
The complaint is more than one
incident.
Potential misconduct,
right,
in its investigation.
Mm-hmm. And everything else was unfounded.
The only misconduct that was sustained was conduct unfounded.
For the cursing?
Yes.
Do you know how long it took the command staff to deliver a judgment on this?
I do not.
You're not? Would it surprise you if it was more than 2 weeks that it sat in the captain's office?
No.
Do you know why it sat in the captain's office for so long?
No.
Is that normal?
I don't know if that's normal or not.
I mean, usually it's either clear cut or, you know, it's pretty clear cut.
I don't know what the time frame is on
from beginning an investigation in the field until it's complete.
Did you ever hear any of the command staff speaking about this incident?
No.
That's all I have.
Any questions by the board?
Yes.
Doug,
just one question.
Well, you use this capital language you've just been talking about. Yes, in school or the phone.
Was on the phone, sir.
Church.
Got to ask him. We'll get with him.
Sergeant Boyer, where are the officers involved that were involved in this investigation? You're telling us about it. Are any of those still on the force?
The majority of these officers, Sergeant Latonis does not work here anymore. The rest of the command staff, many of them are not here anymore. And so we're just providing this as an overview of another discipline issue. But the majority of these people don't work here anymore or were unavailable. Ms. Estes, we debated bringing her in, she was extremely reluctant. I had a personal conversation with her on two occasions, in person and on the phone, and she was extremely reluctant to come testify. And I actually discussed that and decided that I would not bring her in here to testify because she was extremely distressed at the thought of the individual.
I don't have any more questions.
Thank you.
Go back to your seat. Any other witnesses?
Sergeant Andrew Chilton.
Ask him to step in.
And exhibit and testify to that as I did in the previous one since that witness is not here.
Okay.
Was to him during the entire encounter that he made the comment that the complainant made the comment that
Deputy Skowronski didn't have anything better to do today, and Mr. Skowronski said to him that he did have something better to do today, and that he would go ahead and do this report. Because this was the second complaint on professional image, the recommended punishment was an 8-hour suspension. In the previous year, there had been one of the other violations that we discussed for professional image. And Sergeant Chilton says that he's talked with Mr. Skowronski about what to say when dealing with an irate person. And even though this comment was meant to be funny and lighten the mood, that the complainant, Mr. Shirley, didn't take it that way. And that that was a violation of our professional image policy. This one was also concurred from the sergeant, from Sergeant Chilton, all the way to the sheriff again.
Anything else?
No, sir.
Again, he has no direct knowledge of this. Is Sergeant Chilton working today? I also subpoenaed him for this, and I would like to be able to speak with him in regard to this, if not possible.
Well, if he's subpoenaed, then we'll deal with that in your case.
I have no questions for him, so I'll follow up on this. Sergeant Chunks, right?
All right. Okay. Take your seat. Do you have...
Mr. Page, do you have any questions?
No, sir.
About Tom?
No, I do.
All right. Why don't we take a short break, 5-minute break, before we resume back?
How many more witnesses do you have to call?
That is my last witness.
Yeah. All right, so you're ready to rest?
I have a couple more exhibits that I just want to tender, but no more testimony.
Okay. All right, we'll take a break. You can get together your exhibits that you want to tender, and then we'll move into your case. Get back. We'll start back at 1:25. You got 10 minutes.
I would just like to tender these with the highlights on the areas that I feel are important to focus on to conclude this portion.
Mr. Neville, you're new, but we have always honored the civil service documents as being standard issue, and we don't necessarily have to have those put back into that.
Yeah,
our book stands as it's signed.
So, yes, it's not necessary. Tender those as exhibits as part of the case. If you just want to refer the board to what you're
And I could do that in closing, too. I just wanted to make sure that I could do that at the appropriate time and not miss that opportunity.
Sure. But we've always just honored our book as being the rules, and we have, each one of us have a copy of that.
Yes.
If you want to point out which ones you want us to know, then that's fine.
Yes.
And you can do that now or at the close for both times.
I'd like to do that now if I could.
Okay, go ahead. Excuse me, Mr. Neville.
Sure. Yeah, that's fine. That's fine.
In the policy 8 under disciplinary actions, in your policy, as it is in the sheriff's office policy, that some of the prohibited conduct offensive to supervisors, co-workers, or the public is not tolerated. And this can lead up to and including immediate termination. A disrespect to a supervisor, coworker, or the public, violation of departmental rules, profane or abusive language or discourteous treatment of the public or other employees, disgraceful conduct, violations of the applicable departmental SOP. As it says in section 4, that under progressive discipline, although that the elected officials aren't required to follow the steps of the progressive discipline, they are encouraged to. In the those are the relevant sections that I wanted to address now, that where our policy and the civil service policy are in complete sync with progressive discipline and with recommendations for punishment, that there is not a difference in those two policies in this case.
All right. Thank you. Anything further?
No, sir.
Okay. All right. So does the county grasp at this time?
Yes, we do.
Okay, Mr. Skowronski, your attorney, you want to call your first witness if you want to testify.
And who will it be?
Deputy Hyde.
Hi, Deputy Hyde.
Serious situation, would you have any concerns with me being as your backup?
No.
Would you be able to say the same thing about anybody else in this department? About everybody else?
Would I have concerns about other people?
Yes.
What would I do for you?
Do you have any concerns about repercussions for being here today?
No.
Deputy Hyde, were you aware that Mr. Skowronski had 6 disciplinary action recommendations during the prior 3 years before he was terminated?
I did not know he had 6. I knew he had a couple issues, but I don't remember being that much.
You have to speak up just a little bit.
Sorry. Okay. You want me to repeat that?
If you don't mind.
I knew he had a few issues. I didn't know it was 6. I don't remember exactly how many there were, but
if one of those involved turning in a timesheet to get paid for a job that he did not work or didn't work the majority of, would those things change your opinion of whether he should continue to be an employee of the sheriff's office?
Yeah, I mean, if you turn in something that you didn't do and say you did it, that should, I mean, you shouldn't then get paid for it. Or
thank you. I have no further questions.
In regards to Sergeant Waters' question, if I told you that it was a mistake on my part, fully admitted to it, and tried to correct the situation, would you still have the same opinion?
I mean, if you were trying to correct, I mean, if you were able to go back and fix everything, I mean, I would think that would be fine.
I have no questions.
Okay. Any questions by the board? Thank you, Deputy. May be excused.
Can you send that number, please?
No.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You said you worked Avenue just a few times?
Yes, sir.
Are you familiar with the off-duty job policy?
Yes. County policy, yes.
Are you familiar with the policy where you're supposed to call out and let somebody know that you're there?
Yes.
And that you're accountable for the sheriff's office policy while you're there working?
Yes, sir.
And that you're bound by the same rules and regulations?
Yes, sir.
So if Mr. Skowronski didn't work the shift that you've worked a few times at the avenues, but turned in a sheet saying that he did to get paid for the full shift, even though he admitted that he hadn't been there, would you consider that dishonest?
Being that you're saying if he turned in a sheet saying that he was there when in fact he admitted that he was not.
Yeah, so he admitted he wasn't there for the whole time.
Yes, I'll consider that dishonest.
Would knowing that Mr. Skowronski had six prior disciplinary action recommendations for conduct of the company, professional image, failure to read, understand, comply with orders, and various things that resulted in suspensions and writtens, how would that change your opinion of whether he should be an employee of the sheriff's office?
It's kind of a difficult situation. Having worked with him in the past on critical calls, stressful calls, I've not had any concerns. And with him being back up, would that raise some of my concerns? Yes, it would.
I have no further questions.
Again, in regards to Mr. Sergeant Boyer's question, if it was explained to you that it was a mistake on my part, fully admitted to it, would you have any reason to doubt that?
From my personal experience, no.
As far as the previous discipline that I've received, do you have any knowledge of what it entails?
No.
So it could be minor infractions that you would think were silly, or they could be something major that would warrant. And without knowing exactly what discipline has been shelled out, do you think we could make a fair assessment of somebody just by going by that?
Just knowing that you supposedly have been written up a few times? Without knowing the circumstances, I would say.
Have you ever been written up for anything?
Well, my previous employer, law enforcement, Hall County, what have you ever had?
Have you ever been in a situation that possibly could have been written up?
I would say it happened to you.
Was it not written up due to somebody not complaining or just overlooked?
There has been times I would say that complaints could have possibly been made. It's hard to say. I've had verbal counsel in some certain situations.
In regards to conduct unbecoming, are you aware of what the policy states?
Somewhat.
I believe Sergeant Boyd entered that in earlier.
I have read over it before. It's not been recent.
Thank you. This is the conduct then becoming. If you could read that real quick.
Out loud.
engaging in conduct on or off duty which adversely affects the moral or efficiency of the agency, or on the alternative, engaging in conduct on or off duty which has a tendency to destroy public respect for the employee and or the agency, and or destroy confidence in the operation of the county service, the conduct of Cumming, or service is conduct of Cumming and is prohibited.
How specific does that sound? It sounds very vague.
In my opinion, there would cover a wide range of things there.
So if I said it was vague, it'd be a pretty good idea. So that leaves pretty much almost everything open for interpretation as conduct on the company. If a person, a civilian walking down the street, sees you and you have your music up a little loud,
they don't like it, they can complain. That would fall under conduct on the company, wouldn't it?
Yes, definitely is.
Sorry.
No recross. Members of the board, any questions?
Deputy Miller, I just have a couple of questions. How long have you been with the Sheriff's Department?
I've been employed with Forsyth County for going on 5 years.
We appreciate the job all of you do. It's not an easy job. When you make an arrest and you take evidence into your possession, what is standard procedure? What's department policy? Say drugs, whatever. What do you do with it?
Typically, I would, as soon as I finish up in jail, whatever paperwork I have to do, I would return to the precinct, fill out the proper paperwork needed, and drop the evidence into the evidence locker to be picked up by a property and evidence personnel.
Is it, I mean, we're all human, we all make mistakes. Is it possible to forget it for a day or so?
I have personally have not forgotten it. If related to drugs or anything like that, I have seen it forgotten before. So yes, it does happen.
What would you think would be a reasonable amount of time to forget it? A day or two? A week? Can you forget it for a couple of weeks? I mean, does
it's
it
hard matter? To say. I mean, you've got your patrol car is your mobile office. Some of them are much messier than others, depending on how busy the day is. Personal opinion on that would be a day or two maximum. I mean, it's hard to say. It depends on what you're talking about.
If it's a controlled substance, if it's drugs, if it's unlawful to have in possession, I mean.
Well, I don't want it in my possession. I want to drop it as soon as I can. But yes, I have seen people forget about it for a day or two.
Thank you.
Okay. Estimate how many times you've worked off duty in that use.
3, maybe 4.
Would that be a 4-hour shift? Or
I mean, I believe it's typically, I haven't worked it in a while, but 7-11 maybe?
That'd be 4 hours.
Yes, sir.
What would constitute the makeup of those 4 hours? What would you do? Would you stay in your car the whole time? Are you dismounted sometimes? What do you do?
I'm not wanting to stay in the car for a long period of time. I'd get out, walk around, call the people.
So you were busy, and you testified, I believe, that there were times that you didn't see anybody, their security in the 4-hour shift. Is that correct?
That's correct.
When you got through, did you fill out a time card, turn it in that night, next day, mail it in? How did you handle
it? Typically, it would be my next working day. I would fill it out and drop it off in person.
On the last day you worked, how did you get it back to them since you haven't worked since then? How did you get your time sheet to?
I worked the part-time and then.
Well, what I want to know is how you turn in your time sheet.
I would always deliver it in person.
In person?
Yes, sir.
And you just said that if you knew you were working next Tuesday, you would wait till the next Tuesday, the next time you were down there to drop it in?
Typically, yes.
Typically. But if you didn't have a scheduled work day after the last time you worked there, Did you just take it the next time you were down by the avenues, or did you mail it in?
Well, I've always had a scheduled work day very shortly after my part-time at the avenues, usually within 2 to 3 days.
So even though you weren't working for them, y'all's precinct is right across from the avenues?
It is.
So you would just drop by and turn it in?
Yes.
Did they ever say anything? We didn't see you last night or anything like that? Did you ever, since you didn't see anybody, they obviously didn't see you.
No, I've never had any of them
question whether
I was there or not.
So for the 4 hours you were most of the time out walking around?
Just, I would drive a bit, get out, walk.
Just being visible.
Yeah, go in stores, say hello to people.
Do you, you been in the military?
That's right.
I have no further questions.
All right. You're excused. Thank you, Debbie.
Do you mind getting purple for me?
Yes.
Thank you.
State your name for the record.
Rodney Purple.
Is that R-O-D-N-E-Y?
Yes, sir. Last name, P is in Paul, I-R-K-L-E.
And what is your employment?
I'm a deputy with the Shock County Sheriff's Office.
Your witness.
But, how long have we known each other?
About 5 years.
In that 5 years, have you ever known me to lie when someone's found me?
No.
If I make a mistake, do I own up to it?
Yes.
Have you ever known me to intentionally try to deceive or be dishonest?
No.
In your own personal opinion, having worked with me before, do you think I'm a good officer?
Absolutely.
In a critical incident, would you have any issues with me being the backup party?
Not at all.
Would you prefer me?
Absolutely.
Are you able to say that about everybody else in the department?
Not everybody, no.
In regards to the avenue incident, if I tell you that I made a mistake and turned in a timesheet that wasn't right and tried to correct that, would you believe that I was trying to be dishonest and trying to get paid for not doing work?
No.
I have no further questions.
Redirect. Cross examination.
If you worked a part-time job and you were unable to work the entire time or any of it, and you mistakenly turned in a timesheet for the full time, and it was brought to your attention by the sheriff's office that this had been turned in, that you had not worked it, what would you do then?
Not correct that situation.
And if they told you at the avenues that you could turn in a timesheet for the time that you did work, 30, 45 minutes an hour, would you turn that in?
Yes.
And if somebody who was in that same situation and didn't turn it in, and the original time sheet was destroyed, and there was evidence that, and they admitted that they would have gotten paid. Would you consider that to be dishonest?
Yes.
Sorry, that was long.
Yeah, yeah. I work nights, so I'm a little tired.
If you had evidence that a timesheet was turned in for 45 minutes, or I'm sorry, a timesheet was turned in for 4 hours, and then it came to their attention and they went back and got that timesheet and said it was an error, you said that you would then turn in the correct timesheet.
Right.
If it was an error, you would do that. If they didn't do that, and then they admitted, if I got paid, I would have just got paid for the whole 4 hours. Would you consider that dishonest?
It really depends on the scenario. I don't know the whole scenario in this. If I turned in a timesheet accidentally and I didn't catch it, somebody else caught it, and I got paid for it, then I wouldn't know that there was a mistake made until somebody brought it to my attention.
Right.
You know, so it just depends. You know, if it's me personally, you know, it wouldn't be dishonest. It would be my mistake. I shouldn't have done that. I need to fix it, but, you know, I guess it depends on how, you know, I find out about it.
Okay. And if you didn't turn in another timesheet for the actual time you worked, then you just wouldn't get paid for the job at all, correct?
Right.
Is that common? To not get paid for working?
No. No, it's not common.
Wednesday evening, I picked her up from the in-home Bible study and asked, hey, what'd you learn in Bible study? She said, well, you know, I met this guy named Michael. Michael's into acting and modeling. I looked there and said, you did go to an in-home Bible study, right? She's like, oh, yeah. Okay, well, tell me more. Well, you know, he says it's really easy to get into, you know, acting and modeling. All I have to do is send him my picture. And I said, who's this? I mean, is he your age? No, he's about your age.
What?
So she told me a little bit more about it. He had asked, you know, about her phone number and her Facebook, stuff like that. And so I dropped her off at home, and knowing the homeowner, I went back, knocked on the door, spoke with Jack, and said, hey, is there a guy by the name of Michael here? He said, yeah, he is. I said, would you mind getting him? I need to talk to him. So when he came outside, I asked him what he was doing, talking to my 12-year-old daughter. She's 14 now. What are you doing talking to my 12-year-old daughter about acting and modeling and telling her that you can send her a picture? You know, send her a picture to you. That's a conversation that we need to have. You as an adult should be, hey, look, I don't need to talk to you about this. It wasn't as nice as you and I, or the conversation is right now. It was a little more heated. I dropped the F-bomb, and he filed a complaint. Never identified myself as a deputy. He filed a complaint. That night he called, didn't want to stay around, called the next day. He was interviewed three different times. His story changed three different times. It went from me threatening to punch him in the face, to me threatening to stomp him in the face, to me threatening to kick his teeth out. And in my statement, I wrote out exactly what I said. And because I cursed in public, that fit the classification for what conduct of becoming all due. Where my thought process is, it's me defending my child. Lucky you wasn't handcuffs and beat the blood bullet. Talking to my 12-year-old mom. So yeah, I got rid of that.
What was your discipline?
It was a written verbal reprimand. As you can tell, it still kind of fired me up.
And that was regarding your child, off duty, correct?
Yes.
And you're aware of the incident that I had with the school concerning my son. Somewhere along the same lines,
correct? Yes.
Granted that you had your own incident and you were written up, do you think either one were warranted?
Honestly, no, I don't think mine was warranted at all. If anything, it should have been investigated as a crime, possibly. In my thought process at the time, I tried to think of everything I could see if he had violated state law. There should have been an investigation into if a crime was committed at all, period, but it wasn't. It was turned over to Chad.
It was focused on you.
Right. It was focused on me. It was turned over to Chad and Thomas for investigation, which I had called him and told him about the incident. That night, I called him and told him about the incident. He told me his exact words to me were, "I would punch him in the face. You got nothing to worry about." Next day, come in, they asked me about the incident. I told them what happened right now, the statement. That's how, when a complaint comes in, that's what happens. Well, if I do anything wrong, he's like, "No, again, I would punch him in the face." Okay, well, 3 weeks later, he calls me in and says, "All right, well, I've got to give you this written verbal reprimand. It will stay in your file. It won't go anywhere. But, don't cuss at me." Well, sometimes it happens. It does. You mess with my family, that's fine. I take care of, that's my responsibility as a father to head of my household is to take care of my kids. And unfortunately, that situation was one of those situations where I trusted the homeowner, it's church related, there's no reason why, So.
When you're informed by the department of any mistakes you've made or any possible complaints, what was your first initial reaction?
Ask that again.
When you're first notified by the department that you made a mistake or that there's a complaint against you, what's your first initial reaction to that? What's your gut feeling?
Before I was laid off, or before I was fired, or before I was, after I been brought back? Yeah. Well, the old administration, it was immediately, "Oh crap, are you going to fire me?" I can't speak for everybody, but that's the way I feel. Any mistakes that were made were depending on who made them or what the mistake was. But yeah, it was a uh-oh, what I do.
So, in your opinion, and the people that you've spoken to, that on shift, the general consensus would be crap.
Right.
I'm going to get written up.
Suspended, fired,
over whatever.
Right.
And that's pretty much been the norm.
It's been the norm since I've been here.
Is that still continuing?
And that was also, no, it's not. But I've only been back since June 27th, so I haven't felt that way, nor have anybody else that I've run into has felt that way that I'm aware of. But also depended on precincts, too, at the time. Depending on the different precinct commanders. Up north, they hammered. If you made a mistake up north, they hammered.
Yeah. How long have you been with the Sheriff's Department altogether?
About, let's say, 5 years, 6 months, somewhere in there.
During that time, have you heard of other instances that were pretty much pushed aside because of where a person worked or who they were?
Before I left, yes.
Did you, at some point, have a conversation with Sergeant Reeks regarding the incident at the avenues concerning him?
Yeah, I talked to him, what week is this? I'll say I ran into him last week.
What was the gist of that conversation?
Just that this trial was coming up, that he was going to be a part of it, and I was going to be a part of it.
But was there any mention on what he said he had recommended initially?
I believe he told me he had recommended about 8 hours or something. I believe that's what he said.
So he never told you he recommended termination?
No.
And he never told you he recommended anything more than 8 hours?
No. And it was just maybe a 3 minute, 4 minute conversation. It wasn't detailed on that. He didn't say that there was termination recommendation.
I don't know. I have no question. Very
simple. Deputy Purple, just a couple of questions, please. When you work part-time and you fill out a timesheet, what's on that timesheet? You put the duties that you performed at the time?
It depends. It depends on who you're working for. I've seen all kinds of different timesheets, and sometimes it's just a phone call, hey, I work this time and this time. But if it is a timesheet, it's usually the company you work for, and then a block of, there's just blank blocks, you know, that you fill in. And I've seen two where they were pre-filled out, where it was days, like you had Monday through Sunday or something like that. So it really depends on where you work. I've worked many part-time jobs where there was no timesheet at all. It was just your name, Social Security number, and what days and hours you work.
But on certain timesheets that require you to put the duties you perform, do you do that?
I've never seen a timesheet that says what duty I perform now. In order to work a part-time job, say you had, LWD services, and you wanted protection at night, and you talk to somebody at the sheriff's office and said, hey, I need somebody here to watch this, and that part-time request would come out for volunteers. Mm-hmm. So if you volunteered for it and you got it, then you would have to fill out a form for the sheriff's office asking for permission to work that part-time job. You could take that to your supervisor, and in that, there's a block there that says what duties are you going to perform. Is it security, is it directing traffic, or whatever. That form is with the sheriff's office. I don't believe I've ever run into one of those part-time what duties are.
Okay.
I've never worked the avenues either.
On the timesheets, they do ask the number of hours you work.
Yes, the ones I've seen.
Have you ever turned one in showing the number of hours that reflected a number of hours that you worked and you signed saying this was correct, but you didn't work those hours?
No. I don't work very many part-time jobs. Very rare.
Would you turn in a timesheet that said you worked a certain number of hours? You signed it stating all that information was correct?
No.
Thank you.
Dr. Howell? Well, I want to know how long you were separated from the department.
11 and a half months.
What was that in? Was that job related? I mean, were you terminated?
You don't remember me?
You trying dogs?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I sat before y'all July, August of last year. I was separated under Ted Paxton for speaking out on Facebook.
Okay.
Yeah. Now you remember?
I remember. I saw you on tape today. I don't remember you coming before, but we've had several. Have you ever been in the military?
I have.
How long were you in the military?
4 years, and I've been deployed to Afghanistan as a private contractor.
I'm sure you came into contact with soldiers that you would want them to be in the foxhole beside you in a firefight.
Absolutely.
But in peacetime, you just couldn't get along with them, and they couldn't get along with people. Have you ever met anybody like that?
No, sir.
You ever seen the movie Patton? You know who General George Patton?
I know who it is. I'm not sure if I've seen the movie.
Well, it's a great movie about his life. Patton was a great war general. He could never make it in civilian life. He had to have a battle. He had to be protecting somebody's back.
Right.
You ever known anybody like that?
When I was in the military, all we could talk about was when we were done. It was
time when you were going to get home.
Yeah. When I was in Afghanistan, it was like, well, we knew how many hours it was before we got to go home. So, and the people that you run into in that type of, in that line of work, I mean, you know everything about them. You know the kids, the names of their kids, when their birthdays are,
know, what their bad habits are, you know, things like that. I can't say that, you know, those people that I chose to work with like that, that I became close with, that I want that fine symbol. I can't say that once after that was over with, we were back home, but we were still friends. I mean, I've got
people. You would be friends, but they were so geared to the battle that getting along in society, they have a lot of problems getting along. But
I've not read anybody like that. I've read about it, but yeah. I've not read anybody.
Follow up question, Mr. Peary had. Could you fill out a timesheet and mistakenly turn it in for time that you didn't work?
Anything's possible. In my, you know, 5.5 years, a few part-time jobs that I've worked, there have been very few times that I've had to fill out anything, other than the request that the sheriff's office requires for permission to work that part-time job. So, the only few times that I can remember of that I ever had to turn in a timesheet, and usually that was handed to me well in advance. It's filled out, dropped off, you know, at some security office or something like that.
Are you a Forsyth County native?
I am.
Well, I should talk with you. I've got purple blood in me, too. We might be in. I don't have anything else.
All right. Thank you, Deputy Kirk.
Can I be dismissed?
You're excused.
Thank you.
Can you send in Amos, please?
I can.
Thank you.
State for the record your name.
I'm Deputy Sheriff Jonathan Mark Amos.
And you're a Deputy Sheriff with Forsyth County?
I am, sir.
Deputy Amos, about how long have you been in jail?
About a year and a half.
In that time, have you learned anything that I've taught you to make your job better, make you better at your job?
Yes.
Have you ever known me to lie or be dishonest?
Yeah.
If I make a mistake, have you ever known me to try to make an excuse or lie or cover it up in any way?
No.
Have you ever made any mistakes while doing this job?
Yes.
Such as paperwork or?
Yeah, various things. Yes, I have.
And what happened with one of the instances? Is there one that sticks out in your mind? Paperwork or just the way you handled something?
I think I received verbal counseling for the mistakes that I've made.
We've been on quite a few calls together. During those calls, dealing with the public, have you ever witnessed me be rude, disrespectful in any manner towards any person in the public?
Yeah.
Are you aware of, during our conversation, conversations, the majority of discipline I've received? Some of them?
I don't know everything, but I...
In regards to the avenue, we discussed that prior to my termination.
We did.
Is there anything that I did or anything that would make you believe I intentionally was trying to get paid for not being there?
No.
And when I explained to you that it was a mistake on my part and I was trying to correct it, was it, do you have any reason to doubt?
No.
Cross-examination.
I have no questions.
Members of the board?
Question?
Do I?
All right. Thank you, Deputy. May be excused.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Can you send in Deputy Carter?
Yes.
Have you ever known me to lie?
No.
Or be dishonest in any way?
No.
Have you ever known me to intentionally try to deceive anybody for whatever reason?
No.
Any mistakes that I've ever made that you're aware of?
No.
Do you agree that I've fully admitted to every single one of them? Or however you'd like to say.
Yeah, I've heard you admit to things that you've done wrong yourself. Yeah, I've never heard of anything.
You started law enforcement when you came to this department, correct?
Yeah.
Was I able to teach you anything during the time that we worked together?
Yeah, you taught me a few things that you brought with you down from New York. Yeah.
Were they good things?
Yeah, they were good things.
Okay. Do you ever work part-time jobs at all?
No, I don't.
We've been on various calls together. Have you ever witnessed me be rude or disrespectful to the public during a call?
No, you've already been a great episode, bro.
In your past 6 years doing this job, have you ever made any mistakes?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Every day.
What usually happens when you make a mistake? Does somebody else call you out on it, or do you realize it yourself?
If I'm with somebody else, sometimes it'll be pointed out. If I'm by myself, then it's something I'll just catch myself on later.
If somebody points something out to you that you made a mistake on, do you try to correct it right away?
If I can.
That's all the questions.
Cross-examination?
No questions.
Members of the board?
No questions.
Okay. Thank you, deputies. May be excused. Who is up next?
Kennedy?
Kennedy, I'll have you go.
Thank you.
Raise your right hand, you swear to testimony you're about to give in the matter, help me to be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the true self, you know?
Yes.
What is your name for the record?
Tallant Kennedy.
What is your position?
I'm a W first class, so I can't share those.
Kennedy, how long have we known each other?
Four and a half years, something like that. Since you started working the road, you got hired, you went on same shift.
Have you ever known me to lie or be dishonest about anything?
No.
Have you ever known me to try to hide or cover anything up?
No.
If I make a mistake, do I readily admit to it?
Yeah.
And if it's a mistake, I correct. Do I usually not try to immediately correct that mistake?
Yeah, you do.
On, we've been a lot of calls before.
Absolutely.
Some went sideways.
Right.
Some were easy.
Right.
When something went sideways, would you ever have a concern with me needing backup?
Not one bit. I always knew if anything happened, you'd be there. There's multiple people that tell you that. So.
Can you say the same thing about everybody you work with?
Not everybody worked with them.
On the other calls that didn't go sideways, have you ever witnessed me be rude, unprofessional, or disrespectful to the public?
No, you're blunt. I mean, just blatantly blunt for the most part. You always know where you stand. But I wouldn't say I'm professional or anything.
How long have you been employed with this area?
About 6.5 years.
And this is your first stint in law enforcement, right?
Yes.
Have you ever made any mistakes in the 6 years?
Yeah.
Anything that you've been called out on?
I've had complaints and stuff on this stuff, yeah.
Have you been written up?
No. Not that I've had anything time-wise or anything going on.
But there have been complaints with them?
Yeah, absolutely. You don't do this very long, but I have complaints on
you. Off the top of your head, anything wrong with complaints?
I've had a couple people say I wasn't doing my job and not doing reports and stuff the way they wanted it done, and it's always been something that was, they found it to be false. So.
When any of your mistakes are brought to your attention, what's your first reaction to it?
You always defend yourself, you know, explain what happened or what didn't happen, and then you go from there as far as you got to do statements or whatever to fix it. So.
Cross-examination?
No questions.
Members of the board?
No questions.
All right, thank you, Jeff. You could ask someone next to us.
Tanner, Sarah, Chilton's out there too.
Tanner?
Okay.
Thank you.
Yep.
You've known any mistakes that you're aware of that I've made and somebody has brought to my attention, I have admitted it. Fairly admitted to it.
That's correct.
And you're taking the consequences. On the numerous amounts of calls that we've been on together, have you ever witnessed me be rude, disrespectful, or unprofessional towards the public?
No, I have not.
Even when on the occasions that we had calls that got physical afterwards, was I ever rude, disrespectful to prison?
That's my recollection.
Have you ever made any mistakes on this job?
You betcha.
Have you ever been written up?
Yes.
For what?
Late FTO paperwork and for not taking a picture of a victim.
For what?
Not taking a photographic picture of a victim.
Yeah. Whenever you make a mistake, it's brought to your attention either by one of the peers or supervisors. What is your first reaction to it?
I'm sure I understand the question.
What goes through your mind? What do you do? Do you try to correct it? Do you get defensive? Do you try to say, hey, this is what happened?
Basically try to explain what I did.
But you don't try to hide anything?
No.
In this department, the one thing that is completely not tolerated is lying. So, you can make your mistakes as long as you don't lie about it. For the most part, it's fess up when you take your licks.
That's correct.
Have you worked any part-time jobs?
Very few. Very few.
you're aware of probably the majority of my discipline that's been handed down to me throughout the years. We've had conversations about most of it.
I know all of it, but I do some of it, yes.
But what's the majority of the complaints that I tend to generate?
How do you think on that for a moment?
Would you say it was language?
No. Maybe demeanor?
Person sometimes.
Yeah.
Enjoy it. Nothing serious.
No.
That most people would consider serious.
Yeah.
I have another question.
Cross-examination.
I have no questions.
Any questions about the board?
No questions.
No questions.
Thank you, Deputy Tanner. You may be excused.
Children.
You could ask Deputy's children.
All right, sir. Investigating this, did you speak to the gentleman on the phone?
I did.
Was he rude to you?
He was aggravated.
Did he seem overly aggravated?
He was still upset about the incident. Mm-hmm.
Do you recall the conversation we had directly after that about him?
About him being an aggravated, not word for word, but I remember talking about him.
Do you remember him saying that if he was younger, he would have beat somebody's ass over this?
I do.
So it's safe to say he was agitated to begin with before I even showed up one night.
He was. He was agitated because of the accident.
On the telephone, didn't he state to you that if somebody hadn't come out and, I don't know, either held him back or pulled him to the side, there would have been problems?
Something to that effect, he said.
So given his already agitated mood from the accident, which when I went to the accident, there was no damage whatsoever. The car was actually parked next to him on his bumper. There wasn't any scratch. As far as in your personal opinion, I don't, you know, we haven't discussed this. When somebody is making a complaint and you speak to them and they're rude, how do you proceed with that?
A lot of times people just want to vent. They want to tell you what's going on and why they're upset. And a lot of people yell when they're upset. So
and
I just look at him trying to get his point across. And he's tactful about it.
In regards to county policy, your hands are pretty much tied at that point to continue the investigation and the right, correct?
If somebody brings a complaint for it, I have to investigate.
So, are there times that people make complaints that you still have to write it up because they're making a complaint that you think it shouldn't be written up?
There are times when I'm able to field complaints over the phone prior to them coming in and writing a verbal complaint or a written complaint. But once somebody makes that written complaint, I have to investigate their complaints. A lot of times I handle complaints over the phone if it's just, you know, this happened to me and the deputy did this or said this, and I'm able to handle it over the phone. You know, the people say they're content with that.
Right. So the way policy is if somebody makes a complaint written, regardless, it's going forward. Whether they have attitude with you or whoever they're making
the
complaint to.
Okay.
So there could be instances where complaints are made and the other party is pretty much the instigator, right?
As far as?
Just making blowing things out of proportion.
Well, people are upset when they make the complaint.
Exactly. So, but it could be said that some complaints that are written up shouldn't be.
No. I mean, if I take a written complaint, then I investigate it. If I feel that the complaint's sustained, then I act on it. If I feel that it's not sustained, then I act on it. You know, people are upset when they complain. And, you know, a lot of times, once they're heard, they're willing to drop it. In this case, it wasn't willing to drop it.
But he was more agitated to begin with.
He was agitated when I talked to him.
Did I curse at him at all?
I don't believe so.
As far as other discipline that I've had, are you aware of some of the instances?
I wasn't the one that investigated, but I'm aware of the other ones.
You have knowledge of the one that pertained to my son?
Correct.
Mm-hmm. And you spoke with then Sergeant Matonis at the time. You guys went back and forth over what to do about it?
Direct. Mm-hmm.
And what was the initial thought process on that?
As far as which complaint? I mean,
to proceed with the complaint, or what was it?
There was several complaints mm-hmm. built into that one complaint.
Okay.
And I know that Sergeant Matonis is the one that spoke to each of the people, mm-hmm. and it came to me as to what I thought about the situation. But I know that there wasn't just your son on the office of school bus,
right.
and she reacts, and then the school brought up other instances
that happened
previously that
were never brought up before.
Right, that we had, but ended up, Sergeant Matonis had to investigate all of it.
Right. During your conversation with Sergeant Matonis, did he ever bring up the fact that he felt like the school was on a witch hunt?
I don't know if he used that exact term, but I know that he had said that I'm not even sure. I wasn't the one that investigated it. I know that he came to me and said something to the effect of, I think it was one person that from the school that didn't like you, but it wasn't the entire school that was on the mission. It was just the one person that didn't sit well.
Do you know, and you spoke with Lieutenant Good at the time about this?
About
the school incident?
No. That was just the start of the problem.
Were you aware that everything else that was brought up by the school was unfounded except for the use of vulgarity?
Mm-hmm.
Had you heard any of the, at the time, the command staff or anybody of higher rank discussing what to do about it?
No, I don't recall.
You have children, correct? Sir? And if the situation was the same for your child, they weren't letting off the bus, do you think the way I conducted myself was completely improper?
As far as getting your son off the bus, you know, as a parent, see, if I were to see my son, this is strictly my own opinion, if I see my son not being able to get off the bus, you know, and I have the ability to get him off the bus, I'll get him off the bus. Now, as far as calling school and cussing him out, you know, that's not what I'm going to do. I'm going to voice my complaint and tell them that I have a problem with the way they do things and see if we can do it a better way.
Have you read that complaint? Have you ever seen the complaint?
If I had, I don't recall it. So.
I'm not sure what went around the department. I used two curse words that day. Same one. Twice. Over the telephone. And that was considered cursing her out. Manner in which I said that, I pretty much even apologized while I was saying it, but I wanted to know what was going on with my son. I mean, would that be somewhat normal reaction for most parents? You?
Normally don't try to curse anyone.
Normally, but when your child is involved?
Even aggravated, I don't.
People we deal with act calmly and rationally.
The majority of the people we deal with are agitated, correct?
Most of the time, so at least one party's agitated.
Is it not a requirement of a law enforcement officer to not be drawn into all of the drama and be able to stay professional?
It is. It's required.
Is that not, in essence, the definition of the professional image in our policy?
I believe so, yes.
To work diligently or with a bearing consistent with the image of a professional law enforcement employee?
Correct. We're held to a higher standard than we have back.
As a sergeant's job for you and I, one of the things that we spend a lot of time on, even in internal affairs, is take complaints. Is that correct?
Correct.
You spend a lot of your time dealing with complaints. Do the majority of those complaints result in discipline?
No. Outside of verbally correcting the problem. Most of the time, people just want to vent, let you know what their problems are, what the situation they had, and if we're able to handle it without them formally coming in and writing a complaint, then that's handled.
So the fact that we investigate a lot of complaints has no bearing on whether we sustain a complaint or not, is that correct? You already testified that you investigate a lot of complaints, the majority of which we don't recommend discipline on. So why did this professional image complaint, like many others that you've taken over your years as a sergeant, rise to the level of you completing disciplinary action?
Because the situation, I know, but I try to put myself in the same situation, but the complaint arises to me. And I've been on several accidents where I personally felt that, you know, a report doesn't need to be written. Obviously, the damage, there's nothing really needs to be done. There's no law enforcement, no criminal activity has been happened to where it doesn't need a police report. But when people are irate, people are upset, you know, they want the police report. For me, it's been easier just to say, okay, I'll give you the police report. It's 15 minutes out of my day, and it's not that hard to do. But with Skowronski's reaction to, you know, the guy was irate and said, you know, I don't have anything else better to do. And the reaction to that was something I would never say in law enforcement. If it's something I would say and somebody took it the wrong way, then I could see not sustaining it. But, you know, being that it was just unprofessional, is my opinion.
And it was actually Mr. Skowronski's job as a deputy to calm the situation and not aggravate it by sarcasm or foul language or any of the other things that they have done. Were there other complaints on Mr. Skowronski while you were his sergeant?
Any specific ones? I don't remember. Outside of the one that Latonis and I were both supervisors, and Latonis is the one that fielded that complaint. But outside of those two complaints, I don't remember any one specific one.
How would you describe Mr. Skowronski's everyday demeanor?
He was, you know, hard to get along with. He was, if there was something said, he would say something negative. Hard to get along with. It was not people friendly on the side.
Was he argumentative?
He would voice his opinion, but not to the point to where he would start an argument. So he would say his negative comments, and I'm sure if I were to push the situation, a lot of times I just took it to him and vent his negative feelings, so I'd let him vent, not be drawn into the argument.
You supervise dozens of employees as a sergeant?
At least.
Have you had a problem with other employees who appeared to have trouble controlling what they said, using foul language in front of civilian staff, people in the public? Have you had
lots of issues with this?
No, it's the, as far as the, those kind of situations, they're few and far between. So, but there's only a couple on hand, so.
That's all.
Have you ever had a bad day, sir?
You ever come to work aggravated already? Mm-hmm. Bad mood? Work just makes it worse?
I don't know. Works, a lot of times, work is not really. It's, a lot of times, a bad day starts at the house once I get to work. I'm able to, you know, that's my opinion.
Right.
And go on from there.
Do you think, even though it's not supposed to, do you think personal lives affect how we do our jobs?
It's not supposed to, but I know it does.
At any point during the time that you were my supervisor, that I was acting negatively or speaking negatively, did you ever ask me if I was having problems at home?
I don't believe so, but I know that you were having issues at home. That's what I did.
Was I ever offered any counseling by anybody that you're aware of?
That I'm aware of, no, but if I would have offered it, I would have been through EAP. Mm-hmm.
But so if I
had, again, I didn't understand. It would have been through EAP.
But nothing was ever offered that you're aware of?
Specifically, I don't remember an instance where I spoke to you about your home life. I know that you were having issues with your ex-wife and your girlfriend. I'm not anxious at all, so. But I believe so.
During this incident, did you ask me if I was having a bad day? Or if anything had happened, say the night before?
Nope.
And I fully understand that it's not supposed to affect our job performance, but we're human, and it does. And this would be one of those incidents that nobody ever discussed or brought up to me. And, you know, I'm not just going to make an excuse and say that's what it was. Throw it out there. Said what I said. I took my punishment. As far as my opinions, have there ever been any problems with my opinions? Just the way I state them, or is it?
It's just your overall demeanor. I mean,
how I come across.
Mm-hmm.
You know where I'm from, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Where am I from?
You're from New York. I believe you have worked there as a law enforcement officer for 3 years.
So do you think my demeanor is different because of where I come from and where I've worked? I come across differently than to a lot of people from this area?
As a general statement, I think there are differences between starting in New York and coming down here than if I were to start here, but that's just the way the country is.
So. People tend to speak differently in different parts of the world. Any of the calls you've been on with me personally, was I anything more than polite to civilians?
In your own way, you are the way you always are.
Have you
questions? Questions by the board?
Mr. Pig?
Sergeant Chilton, have you ever worked with part-time job, security, stuff like that?
I used to work in a whole time.
Can you speak up just a little bit?
Yes. I used to work part-time a whole lot, but over the years I've shut back on.
Those jobs that you worked part-time, did you ever turn in a timesheet reflecting more hours than what you actually worked?
Never. Not one time. It would almost be, I keep it to the minute. The time I got on scene, whether or not I was one of the ones you call out over the radio or not, you know, you just write down the minute on my, either on my hand or on my notepad. And when I finished, when I
pulled away from the job, but whenever I was able to lock out, I'd write it on my hand, and that's what I spent all my time doing.
I'm sure in your many years of your career, you've had many arrests, taken many things into evidence. If you had taken something like a controlled substance into evidence, drugs, what's the procedure? What would you do with it? How long would it take you to turn it in?
It would be turned in by the end of shift.
By the end of shift?
So before I went home for whatever day that was, that's when I would be dropping it. The report may not be done by then, if it was a weekend, but every time you have evidence, evidence has to be dropped by the end of shift. That's just the way evidence is. You don't want to mess up the chain of custody.
And Sergeant, we're all human. I mean, sometimes we forget. Have you ever gotten evidence left in trunk?
Normally sits in my front seat unless it's something so vague that doesn't fit in my front seat. Sits in my front seat as soon as we get to the precinct. When I was handling evidence more than I do now, my tickets, I would take my tickets inside, I would take the evidence inside. I go inside, I drop evidence paperwork, and submit it into evidence, and then I do my tickets. Drop those into wherever they need to be dropped at. There was never a time that I didn't turn it in.
All right, thank you, Sergeant Chill. Thank you, excuse. So any other witnesses?
You'll be your last witness. How long have you been in the state? Not long, just a month.
We got you close. Recess, come back at 9:30 in the morning. We'll resume with your testimony, Skowronski. And then, if there's, I don't know if there's going to be any rebuttal evidence or not. If there's not, then we'll move into closing arguments. Hopefully, be able to get those taken care of before lunch. See you back at 9:30.
Chairman, should we take our things with us?
I would suggest you do. Okay.
So you're home for the morning.
Have a good night.
You too.
Good, how are you doing?
I am a prosecutor in City of Creek, Jody and Johnson.
You didn't find out the job for this?
No.
So you're covering all the school guys?
Yeah, in fact, I'll have to be for a next officer today.
We've not met before formally, I don't think, but I understand you've been in our office a lot recently. Yep, yes, pleasure. And you are from Rockville, is that correct? I think. You live in Brookfield, is that right? I used to live in Brookfield myself.
Okay, bye-bye.
Those are all cities.
Did you all just in traffic?
Yeah, we lived on Funcom, which is kind of the bottom of the neighborhood. When all the water would flood everything, it would be us.
I'm still trying to learn.
Mm-hmm. We were living there then. We had a couple of hurricanes that came from, I can't remember, came from the Gulf Coast or East Coast, but they kind of sat over Atlanta back to back to back to back and flooded that golf course. And they spent, as I recall, several million dollars. That's right. Just unlucky. They were. Not totally, but we lived in a house that had a garage that you drove in, like a basement garage. And so there was a finished part of the garage as well.
I'm wearing the same thing.
Two or three inches of water.
Did you think after all these years?
Enough to make us have to pull everything out of it.
We were very fortunate.
Well, it's just little things.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody says.
I remember a lot of the ranch homes that front on Oak Haven that have the bridges that kind of cross over. I remember a lot of those in a bad situation because that drainage ditch backed up and work couldn't keep up with the flow. Gotcha. I just want to say hi. I've never met you before. I'm familiar, obviously, with your work, and you had been in our office, but I did not have a chance to say hello.
Thank you.
Well, y'all have a good day. Thanks. Good to see you.
Doing a good job.
I'm about to see my people.
Your office sent me this for good duty.